goes, if you introduce Hitler unnecessarily. I'm not going to compare Trump to Hitler, of course I'm not, but he does act like a dictator. And if you listen to those words from Kellyanne Conway, one of his senior counsellors, well, this is the language of white supremacy. Let's call it what it is. This is the language of the extreme right. When you have a White House aide asking a reporter what their ethnicity is, doesn't that make you feel sick? 0345 6060 973. Channel 4 News, by the way, interviewed someone just the other day, I think, asking them for their views. And this was the chilling answer that came out of this gentleman's mouth.
It's all about immigration, right? It's not about trade or Europe or anything like that. It's all about immigration. It's to stop the Muslims from coming into this country. Simple as that.
Do you think you voted to leave the EU to stop Muslims coming to the country?
To stop immigration.
Right.
But the movement of people in Europe, fair enough. But not from Africa, Syria, Iraq, everywhere else. It's all wrong.
There we are. Someone thinking that our membership of the EU means that we've got lots of Muslims in the country. And he comes from a northern town. I don't think that there's much of a direct correlation there, my friend. And I wonder whether you regret Adil Rashid having had his family at some point before he was born come to this country, sir. Given that Adil Rashid took 3 wickets in the semi-final against Australia and helped us get to the final and was a key member of our World Cup winning team. Deary me. I wonder with some of these people whether it's stupidity or badness or a mixture. By the way, I think this is also worth listening to just before I take Lucia's call and Abbas's call and many others too. Sarjeet and Ping and James and Elizabeth and Jim and Mark. This was Shaista Aziz, my friend, a Labour councillor and also a comedian, who I spoke to earlier in the show, meeting a leading figure in a far-right extremist group, Generation Identitaire, in France. And I think in about 2015 on the telly, I think on the BBC. And here's just the gist of that meeting.
I'm the child of an immigrant, but I'm British. I was born in Britain. I'm accepted as being British. I'm a Muslim. I'm European. So in your eyes, how do you see me?
To be very honest with you, you are not a European for me. And if I was an English, I will say you are not an English. We want, as a political movement, to deal this problem. We have the public transport, we have, you know, the airplanes, we have boats, and we can organize peacefully the return.
You want to return people peacefully.
Exactly, exactly. And it's really...
But where do you want to return them to? If they're born here,
yeah,
they're French, yeah, whether you like it or not. So where do you want them to go back to?
For example, we have to know the origin of people, of parents and grandparents, if it's necessary. And we organize with the country, for example, for you, Pakistan, to
go back. You send me back to Pakistan?
Yeah.
Okay.
But I have nothing against you, but you have to see, imagine, if we were 100 millions of Europeans in India, it will be normal that Indian people say, okay, no, don't go to India. No, no, it's normal. You have just to see the streets of Paris. You have more kebabs than everywhere in, maybe more than in Marrakesh or Algeria.
More kebabs?
Kebabs.
There's more kebabs in Paris than there are in Marrakesh.
It could be.
Is that a problem?
For me, it's a problem, yeah.
Why? Is it causing indigestion? I mean, what's the problem?
No, it's not this question. It's first of all, it's the physical presence of another culture, you know?
So the kebab is for you a symbol, yeah, of what's wrong with immigration?
It's one symbol. As, you know, headscarf is another one symbol. As, for example,
which
the mosque.
Which is worse? The
which is different.
The
which is different, but...
Okay, which is more offensive?
It's hard to say. I think it depends. For example, your headscarf is not visually offensive, you know. You have I see that, and it's a I still
do
think,
you like it?
No, I don't like it.
Okay.
I mean, I don't like it just because you show your religion.
Now, what's scary about that is not obviously just that it's out and out racism, but it is identical to what Donald Trump is saying. Donald Trump is saying to American congresswomen they should go back to where they came from. Well, they're American, so where do they go back to? This man is saying, well, what we do, we find out where your grandparents are from, and then we'll put you on a train peacefully, he said, or a plane or a boat back to Pakistan. Presumably, I've got to go back to Austria, even though I was kicked out of Austria, or my grandparents were kicked out of Austria for being Jews. I mean, we have reached a point where the leader of the free world is no different from that man. And here is, by the way, the leader of the free world endorsing Boris Johnson as the next Prime Minister of this country.
I like him. I like Boris Johnson. Boris, I spoke to him yesterday. I think he's going to do a great job. I think we're going to have a great relationship. I think they've done a very poor job with Brexit. I think the previous Prime Minister has done a very bad job with Brexit. What can I say? I mean, it's a disaster. And it shouldn't be that way. I think Boris will straighten it out. I like Boris Johnson. I always have. He's a different kind of a guy, but they say I'm a different kind of a guy, too. We get along well. I think we'll have a very good relationship.
There you go. The president, who was the guest of the Queen on the invitation of Theresa May on an official state visit to this country just a month or two ago, slagging off our Prime Minister, Theresa May, and in the same breath, endorsing Boris Johnson. And I wonder whether you find that quite scary, given what we know has come out of Donald Trump's mouth this week and what hasn't, when he refused to stop those chanters at that North Carolina rally from saying centre back. Given that that is the man that is endorsing our Prime Minister, what does that make you feel? What does that make you feel about Boris Johnson? What does it make Abbas feel in Redbridge about Boris Johnson, about Donald Trump? Good morning to you.
Hi there, good morning, Matt.
I was at the Afghan shop on Portobello again just a couple of days ago. And they said, you haven't had Abbas on for a while. And I said, no, I haven't. I even made a shout out to him the other day and I haven't heard his voice for a while. Where have you been, Abbas?
I've just been quite busy, to be honest. And when the opportunity came to make the call, your sort of program was ending. So it was just a few times I didn't get on.
Well, we've missed you, Abbas. What do you make of this? Because I think that this has been one of the most shocking, if not the most shocking weeks in Western politics that I can remember.
Well, I think it's really sad. I think it's really, I don't know what's worse. Is it worse that people like Donald Trump and Boris Johnson, you know, say the sort of ridiculous things that they say? Or is it worse that you've got all these people actually phoning up defending what they've said and trying to pretend that it isn't racist?
But that's the problem, Abbas. But let's just be clear about that, because it's not surprising that people are ringing up and defending Donald Trump, because although it doesn't, Donald Trump's racism doesn't legitimise racism, because racism cannot be legitimised, what it does is it empowers racists to be racist, to believe that they can get away with it.
Of course.
It's not surprising, is it?
And we've got to realise something, that every cause has an effect. And the causes of bigotry, of racism, have a horrible effect. And history is a testament to what can happen if these things go unchecked. You know, massacres have occurred throughout history. The Jewish community, the indigenous Indians, Red Indians of America, the Aborigines.
Native Americans,
Native Americans, right? I mean, huge, you know, numbers of people, millions of people wiped out. You know, African people enslaved, millions of them, you know, dying in the most horrid conditions because they were seen as less worthy. They were seen as the other. They were seen as, you know, less valuable than the white man. I mean, you know, this sort of rhetoric will have an effect, and it is having an effect, because people are becoming, as you say, empowered. You know, we're seeing race, hate, crime and all of these things on the increase because these people are feeling empowered.
This guy I spoke to earlier, but I think it was Brian in Texas, said that Trump isn't racist, he doesn't have a racist bone in his body, and he would say, if these congresswomen had been French by roots, if their ancestors come from France, he'd have said send them back to France, and thereby he was defending Trump as not racist. The fact is that it is a well-known racist trope to say to someone of colour, go back to where you came from. And so if you say that to someone of colour, you might also say it as someone who's French, but if you say that as someone of colour, you know the message you're sending out, and it is an openly racist one.
Well, there's two or three things there. Number one, I don't think he would have done. But even if you argue that you know, it somehow is legitimate, every American, virtually every American, is an immigrant in America anyway. Most people have only been there for like maximum of a couple of hundred years, maybe 250 maximum.
I've got the figures here. So 44.4 million foreign-born people living in the US today. That's about 13.5% of the 327 million people who live in America. One of those people, as we've already said, Melania Trump, who was born in Slovenia and went to the States, I think, in 2001. 39 million born in the US, but I think with foreign-born parents, just about 12%. So that, in total, if you were born in America of foreign-born parents, or if you yourself are foreign-born, you represent a quarter of that population. The other 243 million have lived in the US for at least three generations. In other words, they and their parents were born in the States. That's three quarters of the population.
Yes, but my point is that their great-grandfather or their great-great-grandfather was not born in America.
Or in Trump's case, his grandfather.
Right, exactly, right? Now, the question here is, he would not have said that to somebody else had they not been, if they had been white. Because they would have just been American, that's it. You know, similarly, I was born in this country, I'm 50 years old. But if I become vocalised against something perhaps the government is doing, people find it quite legitimate to say to me, if you don't like it, why don't you go where you came from?
Well, Matthew Paris has said, he hasn't gone that far, but he has said that we do still speak of second generation immigrants, that's you and my dad, and the expression has meaning, he said. And yes, there is such a thing as courtesy to a host country, even if it's now theirs too. Do you think you owe Britain a courtesy that people who've lived here for generations, their families, don't? Do you think there's something different about you, Abbas?
No, but I think, of course, you should be respectful of any country that your parents have come to or that you've had opportunities in, and you should try to give back as much as you can. That makes you a decent human being. But at the end of the day, if I'm critical about something that the government might be doing or my local council might be doing, people feel that it's okay for them to tell me that if I don't like it, I should go back to where my parents came from. But if I was a white man with Dutch heritage or Swedish heritage or Irish heritage and I had a name called Smith, or O'Connor, or whatever, they wouldn't say that to me.
Or even Stanley.
Exactly. So they're clearly saying it to me simply because they can see that, you know, I'm a brown-faced man, therefore I probably don't originally come from this country, so it's okay for them to tell me that maybe I should go back to where my parents came. But if I was a white man, they wouldn't say that to me. And they wouldn't ask me, oh, where did your great-grandfather come from? What about his great-grandfather come from? Oh, 10 generations ago, you came from Sweden, therefore you should go back to your country. They won't say that. Because I'm a white man, they'll accept it. But if I'm an Asian man, despite being born in this country, paying my taxes and everything else, I'm still going to be classified as a foreigner. And if my kids now, who are in their 20s, are they going to be considered to be a foreigner as well? Are their kids going to... How many generations do we have to go to? Or is it because you can see that pigment of brown skin that we're always going to be foreigners in the land that we love, that we were born in, that we were brought up in, that we want to be a part of? Are we always going to be foreigners? I mean, when I was young, the National Front would spit on us and they would say to us, go back to where you came from, go back to your country. For me, that was Penge, southeast London. That's where I was born, right? And so when Trump says they should go back to their country, that is why we find that offensive, because that's exactly the slur that the National Front racists used to give to us 10 years older, when we were like 8 years old and 10 years old, and these guys were like 20 and 25 years old with their skinheads and their Dr. Martin boots on and everything else. And they would spit at us and they would tell us to go back to our countries. And that's why we find it so offensive. I can't believe the people that are calling up and saying, oh, he didn't mean that, and it's not offensive. These politicians today are playing a very, very dangerous game, because they realize that if you make these type of slurs, you get a huge swathe of votes. You know, David Duke, the guy who is the head of the Ku Klux Klan, when Trump was being voted in, he said, now we have finally got representation in the government. And when Trump was told to denounce David Duke, He would not do so. He said, I don't know who he is. And then when he was explained who he was, he still wouldn't denounce it because they want the votes. They don't care what transpires, whether there's disunity within the community, whether people get attacked on the street, spat at, and are given racial slurs. They don't care. All they care about is getting that, you know, getting power at any cost. And I'm sorry, he is a racist. He said some horrible things, and they are deeply offensive, and they are racist. And you've got to call it out for what it is.
Abbas, very good to hear your voice, articulate as ever. Abbas in Redbridge, 0345 6060973.